What? Somehow, with idiot luck, he opens a lid. It fades in a haze of energy, and a wave of grayish-red particles spill out in a vortex of unimaginable power. They wash over you and through you, rewriting your genetics at the most atomic level, changing you forever. Changing me? Or Erritis? Scanning thoughts of zzzz. What the hell? Ha ha! There's a thing that endures. Twisted and knotted from cast-off flesh, the iron wind has made a puzzle from you, one that asks, who was the greater fool, Erritis for unleashing the wind, or you for letting him? Good God, what? I have some relatively, like, recent, I hope. No. Huh. Autosave. My autosave's from a half, like, 45 minutes ago. From when I came into this place. Oh god. I didn't think that was gonna happen. Okay, so I'm gonna do it all over again, guys, exactly how I did it before. I gotta retrace my steps. Literally. And, yeah, I'll see you guys back. We're done with that. Okay, let's try this again. Ready. Can I talk to her without him doing that?
Yes.
I don't suppose having him go... No, I can't...
What's on your mind?
I can't move him... This isn't like other games, I can't move him independently. Let's try the other option. Because I'm not reading it, it took me like less than 10 minutes to play all that over again. And of course I just saved right outside this room. I did everything basically the same, only I didn't waste her using that, what do you call it? That cipher? So I didn't use that cipher I just had. I had someone else do, I had Tiber do the persuasion deception. Of course that didn't work, but I did it anyway, just to be fair, and then I ended up using intimidation, and then I got the standard. I did it myself, actually. Okay, no, Erritis, I think that would be a bad idea. She nestles the jar close to her, her hands hovering above the controls. A very bad idea. Stay back, you creature of dancing smells. Good smells, I hope. Not like the rest of this place. Or you, m'lady. He blushes and quickly tries to cover his mistake. Not that you smell so bad, all things considered. He hesitates. Wait, you don't have a nose. Skoura shakes her face at him, baring her teeth, and he backs away. Wait, she doesn't have a face. I'll get the Erritis. Tell me again what happened to you. She giggles, the sound slightly obscene. Perhaps the exposure to my... Oh, wait. Perhaps the exposure to my beauty has addled your mind? Quickly then, quickly. I dwelt on the cutting edge of knowledge, and so I sought to harness the iron wind. I found it, oh yes, and it found me. Now I hide here, blind and mourning, with only my prize to keep me company. My companion Erritis has an interesting problem. I'm wondering if you can help him. Let us find out, she mutters, reaching out. Take Skoura's hand. Erritis does so with great reluctance, turning to you, not noticing that his glow is flowing up her arm in fits and starts. I don't know why you think I have a problem. I'm a hero, after all. I don't have any... He goes rigid, eyes rolling back in his head. He thinks, error, error, blindness, agony. What are you doing to him? Sampling the nano-spirits that have possessed your friend, she says calmly, tightening her grip over Erritus's convulsing hand. A single tendril of his golden aura sinks into a hole at the crook of her elbow. How did you sample his aura like that? Blue Tide. Sensors and processors in my chest. The Iron Wind saw fit to merge my flesh with my equipment when it stole my face. She chuckles, and a runnel of drool slips from her too wide mouth. I studied nano spirits, and the Iron Wind turned me into a living pool to measure the things. Never let it be said that the wind doesn't have a sense of humor. How can I purge them? Gold. You can't, she says, shrugging a misshapen shoulder. They've taken root in him, and there they'll stay. Until the end, of course. She smiles. Now it's my turn. How did you learn of your friend's problem? His original personality is trapped in my mind. I could hear them talking. Perfect, she says, though the information doesn't seem to have surprised her all that much. Well, return to your mind and follow my instructions to the letter. Making a note. She wants me to go back to the labyrinth of my mind. Skoura has the faintest gold aura now. Once there, call them by their names. The stronger ones are the Paragons. The weaker ones? She pauses, smacking her lips. The glow around her fades. Cathartics. Call them forth, and they will speak to you. Perhaps you will be able to convince them to leave your friend alone. She abruptly releases Erritus's hand, and he stumbles back, massaging his wrist. I think I slept, Erritus says in tones of soft wonder. I never sleep. His glow returns, inch by inch. And, they think... She's coming for us. Are you sure? Yes. Now, says Skoura, shifting beneath her rags. What else? Examine the jar she holds. Don't open it. Made from an opaque, battered metal, it looks like a repurposed cylinder intended to hold some sort of high-energy matter. Control panels emit small readouts into the air above its surface. The jar thrums with energy, almost alive, and Skoura's lips slobber into a toothy smile. My pride and my punishment, all in one. Then she hides it behind her back. And if you want it, you'll help me regain my sight. If not, you'll never know its wonders. She thinks, perhaps she is interested. This is good. What do you want me to do for you? Do you not listen? I am blind, and I would see. I don't care how it's done. Restore my sight, and I will give you my jar of wind. Are there no chirurgeons? No doctors, you know? Someone with a taste of travel on her scent should have met at least one such. Fine, we'll go visit Demery and Ulbrevik above. I hope to see you soon.
Happy to help.
All right. There's another level. There's a third level.
On it.
But before we do that, we have to get rid of these guys. Can we just get rid of these two? Can I intimidate them to leave or something? All right, let's go talk to the leader. Let's see if we can talk about letting them go. There's only so much he's going to be allowed himself to be intimidated, I'm sure. Nope. do? Just attack them?
Look out below! Above! Sideways!
Hmm. I'm not exactly sure what to do for them. I'm guessing I have to kill the Murdens. I found the three survivors of one patrol held captive by Murdens in the old slave block. Alright, let me continue on for now. Hang tight, guys. Should I close this door? I can't close the door. Can I? Nope.
Of course.
Of course not. Let's see what's down here.
Of course.
Look out below! Above! Sideways!
There sure is a lot of bugs and stuff. 34 shins. That's it. Huh. Pretty empty, huh? Erritis. Anything to say?
What's on your mind?
I have questions for you. I'm not surprised, he says, pleased. I'm incredibly interesting. What do you want to know? Do you have any questions about what Skoura told us? I don't really remember it, he says, chewing his lip. But in the moment before she touched my hand and everything went white and screamy, she seemed nice. You should probably follow her advice. Hmm. Alright, yeah, he doesn't remember. What's in there? As you tug on the heavy door, a panic-filled male voice calls out to you. Hello? Is someone out there? I know you're not Murdens. I can't feel their blasted mental noise. And by all the gods, I hope you're friendlier than they are. Please, you have to help me. For the love of everything you hold dear, please open the door. And, he thinks, dear gods, let it be a rescuer. I don't want to die. Who are you? My friends call me Shinwise. Please, I don't want to die. Open the door. What's trying to kill you? I don't know. I don't know. Tentacled things that hang around the edges of the room. There's blood and bones all over the floor. The Murdens drew me in here, locked the door behind me. I think I'm supposed to be some kind of sacrifice. Alright, let's have Erritis bash it down. Now that I know how to do this crap. 80% chance. Success. You throw your shoulder into the door. Once, twice, and again. At last you hear the locking mechanism snap. You grab hold of the door and it groans open, revealing an emaciated man in tattered... rages? rags. A look of profound shock and fear on his face. Behind him, blood and bones litter the floor. The man is short and dark, and his face is scarred and disfigured. One of his injuries is freshly branded on his cheek. A stylized blade with blood dripping from it. He wears the ragged clothes of a bloom slave, tattered and filthy. He tries desperately to push past you. Let me out of here, I beg you. This is no fit place for a human. He thinks, it's going to kill me. I'll do anything to get out of here, even if I have to kill again. Oh, I'm gonna put you back in there. Before I let you out, I need you to answer some questions for me. He glances back over his shoulder, his nervousness apparent in every twitch, and you can see him evaluating the possibility of just bowling through you. His mental calculus complete, he inches closer but shows no sign of trying to bolt. All right, but please, make them quick. I don't want to be eaten. Tell me what's in the room. Why does it frighten you? He looks at you with incredulity. The floor is covered with blood. The bones are snapped in half, and the smell of death is everywhere. He breaks off and looks behind him, apparently distraught. I don't know what's in here, but I've seen things, tentacled things, moving around the edges of the room. He thinks, is she insane? How does this room not frighten her? What are you doing here? You know that auctioneer outside the Memovera's fortress? The one with too many teeth? He sold me to a merchant, supposedly to open a maw. Then the merchant sold me to the Murdens. That's not even legal. Nobody's allowed to sell slaves to the Murdens. He swallows and glances over his shoulder again. The Murdens threw me in this cell. So he's talking about Parson Flint. The auctioneer. I saw them cast another slave into this room before me. I heard her screaming. So much blood. He looks imploringly past you. Please, let me out. Who are you? I'm Shinwise. I got caught by the Levies when I nicked some sleep wine for my old mother. She's dying, and I couldn't afford a chirurgeon, and I'd never done it before. Thought I'd take a chance on Bloom slavery to pay my debts and get back home. I never dreamed I'd wind up here. He thinks, will she buy it? It doesn't matter. Nobody deserves his fate, no matter what I did. He didn't do that. He didn't steal sleep wine. He killed somebody. What's that symbol on your cheek? That? Tiber appears more closely. That's the symbol they use to brand murderers in the city. You'll notice that I don't have one. The little man's eyes dart left and right. He licks his lips. It's true. I killed a couple thugs in the underbelly. But it was me. It was them or me, honest. Folsom turned me over to the Levies because the ones I killed worked for him. Otherwise, he wouldn't have cared. Oh. Well, he wasn't the one putting those symbols and stuff. That was, what's her name? That we found in the mirror. I have no more questions then. Does this mean you'll let me go? Please. Please. Is that true? It was them or him? I'll step aside, I'll let him go. Without a word of thanks, he bolts past you and down the hall, vanishing around the corner. He thinks, thank the gods, I may be a killer, but I don't deserve to die like that. Gold tie, moderate amount, wow. See ya! He fears something more than he tells us. Still gold and blue. I wonder if it's like a tide? I think it is a tie, like, sort of. So, whatever's in here... I'm gonna save again. I'm almost up to, episode 100, guys. There's nothing here? What's going on now? Something about this room feels off to you. A sensation of being watched and evaluated. The Bloom's walls bulge and press, glistening with a faint sheen like they're beginning to salivate. This space has somehow begun to wake. Great muscles contract in a rippling peristaltic wave, trying to pull you further into the room. Your instincts scream of danger. Yeah. Two companions. Get out of here and let me face this alone. I don't want to endanger you. Gold tide, moderate. Indigo, small. Calistheus says, we can help you. There's no reason to face this alone. Calistheus's face is drawn with worry. But if you insist... I fear no danger, Erritis announces, and in the eyes the glistening walls. But I've already been digested. It's an experience that you shouldn't have more than once. He backs away slowly. I like a good piece of meat as much as anyone, but don't you think this is taking it a bit too far? Tiber pauses, then raises his palms to forestall an argument. Not that I don't think you can handle it, but... Well. What the hell am I doing and why? You are left alone in the glistening space, and then the horror begins. Oh my. Is that... Were those little things the pieces of sorrow? The little maws converge on you. Are they little maws? They can move, though? They can float around? Some of their tendrils holding you immobile, while others tear great chunks from your flesh and toss them into the glowing singularities at their core. You scream. All around you, the bloom responds with excited and gleeful whispers. The sounds of brutal feasting are the last thing you hear as darkness claims you.
I'm hurt.
Yeah, it's, say you're hurt. I guess I'm going into the labyrinth of my mind, the calm or whatever. Well, we can help Erritis. We still have to free those people. Which I guess we just have to, like, slaughter the Murdens. Swirling depths flicker with mysteries and powers you cannot define. Let's talk to Saria. She probably not gonna have anything new to say, but... Yeah, nothing new. At least I don't think so. There's Choi. Bok Choi over here. No, I'm not doing that quest yet. It's quieter here. Yes, the quiet of my mind. Is Inifir and Erritis? Two, where do these go? Clock Fathom and Daughter's Fathom. The Paragons are the stronger ones. Erritis, this timid, realer version of your companion, flinches as you approach, and yet there is a sly flicker of color in his eyes. The creatures tormenting him are watching you and laughing. Can't you think of any way we can get those demons out of you? Yeah. Erritis, I want to talk to the Paragons and the Cathartics. Erritis's head snaps back with a crack. His arms shake, trapped at his sides. A dry rattling comes from deep in his throat. Slowly he looks down, back down at you. One pupil is a vast, flaming red. The other is a muted indigo. And this thing seems to be getting louder. You are speaking with the audience, says countless booming, curious voices from Erritis's mouth. We are not sure why. You should be watching the hero with the rest of us. Did you guys, like, watch, like, too much Indiana Jones or something? I care about him. Then you should let him fulfill the purpose we have given him. His voice is softer, slyer, almost hissing. Before he was nothing, a herder of useless animals. Now he suffers. And in suffering, inspires. That's his torment. Just like in Planescape Torment, everyone had their torment. He was insignificant, and now he is wonderful, the first voice says. Stop interrupting the performance. Let him find his destiny. We will move on after he is done. That isn't good enough. Erritis's multicolored eyes gleam, and he folds his arms. We do not mean to offend, but there is nothing you can do about it, so leave us alone, and we will make him cut his own throat. No, he won't! That is why you aren't in charge. The eyes blink out of sync. Know that we are not many, not anymore, but we have claimed every particle in his body. We hold them in our claws. To remove us is to tear him apart. There's a pause. That is actually true, admits the other voice. We want to make you an offer. Bargain. Stop interfering with the performance and we will increase the excitement, drama, and suspense. We will make the hero more powerful. The audience stretches Erritis' neck from side to side. What do you say? Can't you just leave him alone? Impossible! There is no him anymore. If we leave, he will collapse into a pile of fleshy bits. A pause. Actually, we would like to see that. Yes, we know you would, but we are running a performance here. The red eye gleams. Will you accept our bargain or not? Making him more powerful will burn him out quicker, won't it? Of course, the Paragons say, sounding puzzled, though Erritis' face is completely blank. We weren't trying to hide that. It was obvious to us. The indigo eye flickers. Instead of living for years, the hero will die in months, but he will be more useful to you. The red eye flares. Do we have a deal? This makes no sense. He's your host, your hero. You gain no benefit by ending his performance early. The audience falls silent for a long moment. But you are trying to end his performance pain as well, aren't you? Yes, I want him back to normal. You are not listening. He will never be normal, boring. Again, he will die without us. Another moment of long silence follows. We offer you a new bargain, the Paragons say at last. We will recede, but not reduce. We will avoid shouting. We will never shout. We were talking about we, us, not you, us. Our apologies. Erritis folds his arms. We will see what the hero makes of himself when we do not guide his every step. Is this agreeable to you? Yes, that's acceptable. Done, the audience says together, and the lights in Erritis' eyes sinks beneath the man's pale blue, growing cooler. Unbidden, a sigh of weeping relief escapes Erritis' mouth. Aww. Now, the Paragon says, what else do you want from us? What are you? Erritis bellows laughter and chuckles softly at the same time. You called us, named us. We are the audience, the voyeurs. No, that's the wrong word. The perfect word. Stop it. You are wrong and we are speaking now. The creatures in Erritis stretch his mouth into a merry grin. We are the Paragons. We control the body. Our heroes make the world a hopeful place. The smile slowly fades. We are the Cathartics. We lie beneath the mind and guide his thoughts. We do not believe in hope. There is no hope. There are only those that suffer and those that are pleased to watch. Erritis straightens. This vessel came to us, damaged, boring, useless, afraid. We are saving him from cowardice, fear, because we are healers, warriors. No, we aren't. Stop saying that. This is hilarious. These guys are fighting. We are the Paragons and the Cathartics. We are the audience. Who created you, and for what purpose? Tide. We don't know, care. We were created and unleashed to be entertained, to watch and to punish. That is what we do. Why are the Paragons dominant over the Cathartics? Because when the Cathartics get a hero, they throw it off a cliff or into spinning blades or a volcano just to hear it scream. Lies. You have done all those things and you know it. How did you meet Erritis? Interesting, infuriating question. Do you want the long or the short version? You prefer the short version. We aren't asking you. The long version. A long time ago, we were part of a greater swarm, the Paragons say over a multitude of minor groans. We were not limited to single heroes. We blessed armies with our voices and sent them against each other to entertain and inspire the world. The Cathartics grumble to themselves. We filled the world with hope and excitement, but all people talked about were the dead bodies everywhere. We aren't sure why. Our heroes were hunted down and destroyed. Our swarm was tampered with until we could no longer reproduce. Then we were sealed in a dark place until our hero, your hero, found us. The Paragons beam with Erritis' face. It was his destiny. This question again. You want the long or short version this time? Is it the same exact thing? Short version. We were captured and sealed in a dark place. The hero found us. We rewarded him with purpose. Erritis folds his arms. That is the end of the story. I want to talk to Erritis again. Be our guest. His opinion has improved. Erritis flinches, and the light of the audience fades from his pale blue eyes. I couldn't hear anything, Erritis says, shivering. It was like I was dead. He chews his lip. But I feel... He takes a breath. He feels calmer out there. I'm not in control, but he is... Erritis trails off in confusion. I'm not making sense, but I feel better. Safer. Whatever you did, it helped. Thank you. He even manages a slight smile. What else do you need from me? What if I talk to them again? Nods. I guess we're gonna go back to the ninth world. See what the hell happened to us. What's left of us.
On it. I'm ready.
Are you sure you're ready?
That immortality thing of yours.
Ain't it though? So we've got another... That goes to treasure trove. Cool. So I couldn't even look at these things before. Manacles hang from the top of these plinths. Blood and viscera cover the floor around them.
Go.
Got something here. 38 shins. Now, what did it take from me? How do I find out? I still have 21 intellect like I always did. I don't know. What's missing about me? Hold on. Skoura, a hideously disfigured woman I met in the old slave block, has lost the ability to see. If I can restore her sight, she'll give me her most prized possession, a metal jar containing nano-spirits of the Iron Wind. Find a way to restore Skoura's sight. Skoura didn't give me any leads, but a healer of some kind might be able to help. Okay, so we've got two more to go through now. I have a fettle, but that's because I have the cipher sickness.
Here comes the boredom slayer.
Yeah, you're not boring anymore.
Yes, now.
I guess I have to kill all these.
All right.
Yeah, I guess we're on to 99 now. Usable during combat. How do I fight it? Oh, the guy downstairs, we freed him. Angry static fills your head. The chief puffs up his feathers, looming over you, eyes glittering in the dim light. You free our slave. We pay for slave. You owe for loss. You didn't buy that slave legally, did you? Parson Flint wouldn't have sold him to a Murden. Gold tide. The chief hisses angrily. No, says the translator. Little fat slaver would not sell to Murden, so we steal slave from merchant. That is truth. You so smart? We give better deal. Pay us 200 shins or we kill you. No, I won't pay that. Then you die. Here we go, guys. We got to go first. Tiber.